Penguin Random House Audio presents The Killing of Osama bin Laden by Seymour M. Hersh. Read for you by Eric Martin. Introduction. The reportage in this collection has a common theme: false steps by an American president who came to office in 2009 after a brilliant campaign in which he spoke of hope and change we can believe in. Political words are just words, as people everywhere in the world have come to understand. But Barack Obama's rhetoric, the first African-American president of the United States, seemed to strike a chord after 8 years of George Bush and Dick Cheney. In his first inaugural address, Obama emphasized the rule of law and the rights of man, declaring, "Those ideals still light the world, and we will not give them up for expedience's sake." Yet, he is a president who told the world a series of lies about the killing of Osama bin Laden in May 2011, some of which recklessly put an ally at risk, who in August 2013 sought congressional approval to bomb Syria while concealing the fact he had been put on notice that the nerve agent allegedly used by Assad didn't match any of those known to be in Syria's arsenal, who secretly authorized the Central Intelligence Agency to set up a back-channel flow of arms and ammunition, including anti-aircraft missiles, from chaotic post-Qaddafi Libya via Turkey to Syrian rebels, many of them fanatic Islamists, who ignored repeated U.S. and allied intelligence reports throughout early 2013 depicting the Turkish government, led by President Recep Tayyip Erdogan, as a vital and hidden supporter of al-Nusra and ISIS, two extremist militias then engaged in all-out war against Syria. The White House's refusal to deal with reality led the Pentagon's joint chiefs to find a way, through America's military partners, to get intelligence and targeting information to the Syrian military without Obama's knowledge. Obama's lapses in judgment and integrity in his foreign policy are all the more confounding because he once promised a very different kind of leadership. He spoke elegantly and passionately on issues ranging from racial prejudice and the need for universal health care to the importance of resolving the festering Middle East crisis and closing America's grotesque prison at Guantanamo. He was not a pacifist, as he said many times in different words, but opposed to the rash use of military might. He spoke of ending the mindset that causes war. In an era of money-driven politics and venal, cynical politicians, he was seen by some as the brightest and best president America could hope for. How can one explain a politician who put so much energy in pushing through a healthcare program and a revolutionary nuclear agreement with Iran while taking the deceitful steps mapped out in this book? How could such a high-minded person endorse, as Obama has, the compilation of hit lists made up of suspected terrorists around the world, including American citizens, to be targeted and killed without judicial process? It's now evident, 15 years after the 9/11 attacks, that Obama's foreign policy has maintained many of the core elements of the global war on terror initiated by his predecessor: assassinations, drone attacks, heavy reliance on special forces, covert operations, and, in the case of Afghanistan, the continued use of American ground forces in combat. And, as in the years of Bush and Cheney, there has been no progress, let alone victory, in the fight against terrorism. ISIS has succeeded al-Qaeda as the United States' most feared terrorist enemy, one that now reaches deep into Africa and sends shockwaves into Western Europe and America. Obama still views Russia, a nation sharing the same international terrorist enemies as Washington, as an evil empire that must be confronted rather than as an ally. Since 9/11, I have had access to some of the thinking inside the White House on the war on terror. I learned early in the Obama presidency that he was prepared to walk away from first principles. His first public act as president took place on January 22, 2009, 2 days after his inauguration, when he announced that he was returning the nation to the moral high ground by signing an executive order calling for the closing, as soon as practical, of Guantanamo. As of this writing, that has yet to happen, and more than 90 prisoners continue to fester there, with no due process and no accountability, to America's shame. Obama had described Afghanistan as the right war during his campaign, and talked about the need for more troops on the ground there. Many of his supporters were not listening or chose not to hear. I was told that within 3 weeks of taking office, he informed his senior advisors at a secret National Security Council meeting of his plan to send an additional 17,000 American troops to join the 47,000 already stationed there. This outcome was not the product of an interagency staff decision, but a unilateral action taken by Obama and retired Marine General James Jones, the National Security Advisor at the time. Obama and Jones were said to believe that the focus of American foreign policy needed to be on Pakistan, a nuclear power supporting and harboring the Taliban troops that had become the main opponent in Afghanistan after Al-Qaeda's retreat. There was much hubris and, as usual in new administrations, not much consideration of what had gone before. Furthermore, I was told by someone in a position to know that Jones had explained at one meeting, in essence, that Afghanistan is not in our national security interest, but we don't want to betray the good men who went there before. We will not abandon Afghanistan, but we will not let it get worse. Obama would spend much of his first year discussing what to do about Afghanistan. The debate was not about whether to expand the war there, but how many troops to commit to what would become America's longest and least successful war. The president, who would spend the rest of his time in office cracking down on press leaks and internal dissent, stood aside as a group of American generals staged what amounted to a public debate over the number of troops needed to win the Afghan war. At one point, a highly classified internal request from Army General Stanley McChrystal, an expert on special operations and commander of U.S. forces in the Afghan war, was leaked to the Washington Post within a week of its delivery to the White House, with no significant protest or sanction from Obama. McChrystal had asked permission to deploy as many as 80,000 more troops. Obama eventually committed a first tranche of 30,000 additional American soldiers. It was a decision marketed as a compromise between a reluctant president and a gung-ho Pentagon. There was at least one senior member of Congress who had reason to suspect that Obama, despite his resentment of the military's public posturing, had wanted these higher troop numbers all along. By 2009, David Obie, a Democratic lawmaker from Wisconsin, was chairman of the powerful House Appropriations Committee, one of two committees responsible for funding all government programs, including secret military and intelligence activities. Elected to Congress in 1969, at the height of the anti-Vietnam War protests, Obie was an outspoken liberal. He had dared to take on George Bush and Dick Cheney over aspects of their war on terror that, as Obie and others in Congress believed, were not being shared with, and perhaps were not even financed by, Congress, as stipulated by the Constitution. Obie got nowhere with his protests, but his efforts in early 2005, including a little-noted speech on the House floor and the solicitation of a rush of unfulfilled promises from the Bush White House to provide greater communication, were remarkable simply for having taken place. He told me at the time that disquieting actions had been taken in secret, and Congress has failed in its oversight abilities. Obie stunned his colleagues in 2010 by announcing his retirement. He and I had talked on and off during the Bush years. He would listen, but say little. 6 or so months after he left the Congress, he was more forthcoming. He told me of a presidential meeting he and a few other congressional leaders had attended at the White House in March 2009. The issue was Afghanistan, and Obama wanted them to know he was going to make a significant troop commitment to the war there. He said he was being told by a lot of people that he ought to expand the war, and then asked all of us, one by one, what we thought. The only word of caution came from Vice President Joe Biden, who raised a question about the cost.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.